Welcome to the Love Lives of Sea Creatures, and thank you all for coming to Museum of the Moving Image. Today's program is part of our ongoing Science on Screen series. Over the next few months, we will be bringing scientists and filmmakers to the museum to explore everything from seahorses to insomnia. Science on Screen is a nationwide initiative of the Coolidge Corner Theater Foundation with support from the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. 57 nonprofit cinemas across the country also have grants to pair scientists with films, and I am proud to say that we are the first museum to receive the grant. The Alfred P. Sloan Foundation is a nonprofit philanthropy founded in 1934, which makes grants in research and broad-based education in science, technology, and economics. Its program in the arts funds film, theater, radio, television, books, and new media, which integrate science into storytelling, and it is directed by Sloan's Vice President of Programs, Doran Weber. My name is Sonia Epstein. I am the executive editor of our online publication, Sloan Science and Film, and I am very excited to present to you this afternoon a program of 9 short films, all of which have something to do with the mating behavior of sea creatures. So the films are by 3 pioneering filmmakers, Jean Painlevé, Isabella Rossellini, and Roberto Rossellini, Isabella's father and also the father of Italian neorealism. We have the fantastic scientist, Dr. Mandë Holford, here with us. She studies how snail venom can be used to help cancer patients and sufferers of chronic pain. We also have Isabella Rossellini here with us. As you all know, she is a movie star who has been in everything from David Lynch's Blue Velvet to Peter Weir's Fearless to Abel Ferrara's The Funeral, to name a few. Less known, perhaps, is her scholarship in animal behavior, which has led her to make a series of shorts called Green Porno, which were made in 2008, and we will show a few of those tonight. Rossellini has continued her scholarship, studying at Hunter College in their master's program in animal behavior, and she has a forthcoming book, My Chickens and I, so keep an eye out. So obviously I urge you all to stick around after the screening to hear them speak about all of the films. And after that, you're all invited across the street to Tacuba, the Mexican restaurant, which has extended their food and drink happy hour for all of us until 10 p.m. So we are beginning tonight with Jean Painlevé's films. The film critic André Bazin wrote in L'Écran Français in 1947, "I am afraid that in 1948, Jean Painlevé will have to show his films in the large screening room of the Palais de Chaillot because word is getting out that microbes are the greatest actors in the world. Next year, we will have to ask them for autographs." So with that, let's begin the program. We'll see you afterwards. Okay, so Isabella, I'm wondering, given what we've just seen, if you can remember when you first saw Fantasia Sottomarina and what it, you know, what your thoughts are seeing it today with all these films.
So my father did the film in 1938. That is before the war, before he made his most famous film during the war and right after the war. He made, as you've mentioned, films that were called neorealism. They were feature films, but it looked like documentaries. And this were really, he was in his late 20s. Cinema film was just discovered. I mean, there were very few people that were using film. Maybe I would say the first one was Méliès 20 years earlier. And of course, there wasn't any cinema, there wasn't any television, so we have to remember the context. And I think this world of fish, another world, it was like for us going to Mars and filming the first creature in Mars. My father loved fishing, he went fishing, but I think that, and you can see it in the film, that more than shooting the fish, he would get fascinated by the interaction of all these animals. And I think he captures in this film this amazement of another world.
Yeah, so did you think about that at all when you were thinking, was that at all like an inspiration for you with Green Porno?
No, I didn't. You know, I always loved animals, and my father, also my family, were all loving animals, but I am the only one that as I became older and worked less as a model, as an actress, I went back to university to study animal behavior and made a series of short films about animal behavior. And of course, you can see that the films that are done contemporary, you can't ignore the problem of conservation. You know, even in my film, there is a lot of references to, I've forgotten that image of the fishery at night to fish squid because they are attracted to light. And you see that satellite image with this, that are the fisheries, they make more light than the entire Buenos Aires. You realize the devastation. I want to tell you that all these images, the real images that you see, I blend my films and my animation and me dressed up, but all the films of the real animal were filmed by friends of Claudio Campagna's, and the fisheries are very, very frightened. They were really done underground because for the fishery, they don't want to be exposed to the kind of amount of fish that they take. So all that was filmed underground.
That's amazing. So Mandy, I wanted to ask you, we saw, I think in all of the Jean Painlevé films and in Isabella's films, you see a lot of different methods for reproducing, either hermaphrodites or, you know, which reproduce asexually. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about what the advantages or disadvantages are to that kind of reproduction.
Of course, we can.
For sure.
I mean. Well, one major advantage is, you know, you are your everything. And a chance encounter is guaranteed to result in mating. So for populations with low density and sparse interactions, it's a chance to ensure that when you meet someone, it's the right someone. You don't have to keep swiping left or right. It's there. And what's nice when he showed the threesome or the fivesome for the Aceras, it's great because it increases their number and ensures that they're going to be able to reproduce. A major disadvantage, though, is you don't get a lot of genetic variability when you have hermaphrodites or when you have, like, the starfish who can break off pods and start again. So if your environment becomes threatened or endangered, you don't have a lot of methods for which you might be able to attack that. So when we have sexual reproduction, you know, we have your genes mixing with my genes, which would lead to a whole new pool and might have some protection against whatever might threaten
the virus that can come and kill the entire population.
Exactly.
This is one of the problems, for example, that the sea otter in California mm-hmm. have. This is a repopulation that rebound, but they are all cousins, they are all related.
Right.
And so the great fear now, it's not the number, but the fact that they are very related. So a virus might come and might infect all of them.
Right.
So they are, until they diversify and become individual, because that's the key.
Exactly.
It's to be, you know, we all have two eyes, one nose, and one mouth, but we're all different.
We're very different.
And that's key to the survival of the species.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so so there's, you know, pluses and minuses,
exactly.
It sounds like, in evolutionary.
Sure.
So, Isabella, what first got you interested in sea creatures' mating behaviors?
You know, I think I was born with it. Were you born with it?
No.
I was born with the interest, fascination of animals. When I was looking at the film as different as they were, the three films, yeah. You could see that even in Painlevé and my father and me, there is this fascination with the animals. The three of us were born with it, and then we expressed it. It was the first time that I've seen these French films. I've heard about them, and I didn't expect to be so incredibly scientifically not only accurate, but the imagery,
yeah.
Because they were done right after the war. He was the first one to have an underwater
yes.
camera.
Yeah, he made his own. So he's definitely a groundbreaker, because what he's shown, and as you were saying, he makes three types of ways of sharing his knowledge. He'd make an academic film, a film for the science community, and then a film for the general public. And so what Painlevé was doing is what we call STEAM, science, technology, engineering, arts, and math all together. And at the time he was doing it was really amazing, and that he can get such quality films. He was really inventing new techniques for how to film underwater, which is still a challenge, and then also how to accurately portray the mating that you see. So he has to spend hours. In the lab, we work with venomous snails, and we always try to catch how they feed. And everyone gives up, because it's like you're there for hours and hours, and then you just walk away. So he spent a lot of time and a lot of dedication and a lot of invention went into what he did to make it so accurate.
Amazing. Yeah.
And also entertaining. It was funny. He partnered with a lot of jazz musicians and did a lot of instrumental music that were new at the time to make the films very inviting for the lay audience.
Yes, it was interesting, the choice of music.
Yeah.
It was so... I was thinking, you know, maybe you can help me. I was thinking, what makes them different from, you know, the documentary that we see today from National Geographic? Or I think that that you still see the presence of the author, of their eye, and I kind of appreciate that as much as I appreciate David Attenborough. Mm-hmm. When he does his documentary, he tells the animal, but he tells it also through his emotion. Mm-hmm. And I was looking at this film and I thought, you know, you still see the presence of his wonderment,
right.
And that makes it maybe more artistic. It is cold documentary with a voiceover that tries to be impartial and has no emotion.
I think also his choice of creatures that he picks, the octopus, I mean, it's a very striking animal, and we've all thought of it when we think of Predator and all these crazy movies that have far off things, like you were saying, for Mars. And the Aceras, I mean, that dance that they do is just breathtaking. It's like rose petals underwater. And when you see them on land, they are not that pretty. But the minute they jump up, you're like, wow, you're actually very beautiful.
Very beautiful. For a second, I thought that he put a few frame of Isadora Duncan.
It's Loie Fuller. It's Loie Fuller.
Yeah.
Good. And it was amazing. I'm good that I caught it, because I thought it was on a... But he did it so subtly that it almost... I had the impression that he reminded me of a dance.
He was friends with all of the surrealists at the time. So he lived in Paris, and he was friends with Buñuel and Man Ray, and you know, a lot of artists. And he was exchanging ideas with, you know, these other contemporary artists of the time, and so they were helping him, and vice versa.
But he was also very much a scientist, and a lot of what he produced were the first time we saw those things, like the seahorse. Yeah. Given birth, you know, here's, I was very happy to see that you had included that, because I just had a baby last year, and I was I was showing my boyfriend, I was like, see, if you were pregnant, you'd have the eye rolling and the violent contractions.
Yeah, so... So, Mandy, you study venomous sea snails. Can you talk a little bit about what visual tools you use? You know, we're talking about how Painlevé invented these underwater cameras,
First, I'll say that we don't study the reproduction of the snails, although our snails are sexual. They also have very long penis, and the females will lay an egg on a substrate, but not all of them survive. In our studies, we mostly look for trails in the sand, similar to what you see with the Aceras. We are doing scuba diving and snorkeling. We don't do a lot of visual in terms of filming, like I said, because when we try to study their behavior, it takes a lot of patience, as you may know from your studies as well. And our main focus for now is both in trying to describe the species of snails that we're studying and figure out how the venom they're producing can be used for medicinal purposes and how we can develop new drugs from those venoms.
And I know that you developed an educational learning game where use killer snails. It's called killer snails, but you use snails to engage with students around learning. And I wonder if that was something you thought about when you were choosing what animal to study. You know, sea creatures are these very approachable characters, they're very approachable creatures. And I don't know if you were always interested in education or just what that if that played into
a little of both, right? So the snails are very attractive. The shells have been collected for years and they're stored in natural history museums. And when we made our Killer Snails game, we call it Assassins of the Sea, it was sort of trying to do what he was doing at the turn of the century, trying to figure out ways in which we can make science approachable and fun and similar to what you've done with your green porno films. It's meeting, I guess, the medium where it is now. So apps and virtual reality and all those things are kind of turn of the century film because they're new and people are figuring out new ways to use these media and new ways for using it as a tool, both for education and for entertainment. And sort of what you're doing with the short films, we're hoping to do with games and taking them into the classroom and exciting primarily middle school students are what the first games we're producing are for. But we've just partnered with Google to do a whole VR thing so you can see underwater what it is to go underwater and be in an immersive experience in the classroom. To be living and walking amongst, you can pretend you're a snail and you go around and you eat fish and you eat other snails and you eat some worms and you try not to get captured by the scientist. So there's a little drama in the game, but it's a lot of fun. Yeah, so forming the company was sort of my way of wanting to engage the public in the excitement that we do in the lab. And also why it's important that you know that science is there and it's fun to learn about the sea creatures, also for conservation reasons.
So Isabella, I'm wondering at what point you decided, or if this was always the case, that you wanted to make your films scientifically accurate and work with a scientist.
Well, I thought it was important to do it scientifically accurate because, as you know, you told how difficult it is to film animals. They're quicker than us. They move very fast, especially the ones that live in water. I was with Diana Reese, I hope is here tonight, one of my professor that studied dolphin, and I went to the Caribbean, and we were trying to film them. And now we have underwater camera, but they swim so fast that you just have glimpses of them, and they were gone, and we couldn't catch up with them. So. It really is difficult. That's why I thought, I'll play the animal. I'll make it really simple. That I solved that problem. And I think that they are only funny if I make them scientifically accurate. Yeah. Otherwise, I'm just a crazy old lady that makes dresses up and marbles, you know. It's the only thing that makes them valid.
It's true, and nature already has those crazy stories. You don't have to invent too much.
Yeah, exactly. I agree.
It's really there.
Much crazier.
Yeah, we saw some of that tonight. An early critic of Painlevé's wrote that his films were just entertainment for the ignorant, so to speak. And I wonder, you guys having seen them, do you think that they're scientific? I mean, we're talking about that, but yeah.
Absolutely. And I don't think there's anything wrong with entertaining the ignorant. We need to educate people in all forms, and you have to meet them where they are. And if making a film with a musical background that's funny and throwing in captions from horses jumping over the finish line and all these things will make them notice and maybe want to learn more about the seahorse or learn more about the octopus or learn more about why marine life is important in general, I think it's important. But he did not in any way compromise the science in his work. So, like you also do not compromise the science.
Right. I think that is important, not to compromise the science. Otherwise, the validity of the film is gone. But I have to say that maybe as a scientist, you have the need to inform people that are not scientists. An artist doesn't really have the need to inform. I don't make my film because I have gone to school and now I've learned and I tell you. It is something that comes somewhere else, a pleasure to narrate. You know, I love to tell story, like another person might love to cook or do gardening or do a sport. There is something that I enjoy do. So I do my art not with a goal of, I have to have an audience, otherwise I don't get the money to do the next film. So, but I don't really, and I do it with some, course audience in mind, but it isn't a crowd big as you. It might be two or three or four friends of mine, and I say, you know what I heard? You know what I find out? And that's the spirit of an artist, I think. While, for example, before I was mentioning National Geographic, I think that the general films of National Geographic, there is the need to inform and to reach a lot of people. This other film that we've seen, yes, they would like, everybody would likes to have an audience, but it isn't the primary thing. The primary thing is, I have an emotion that I would like to share. These creatures are Martians. They are so strange, they are so unusual. I want to tell you what it is. And I think there is, you see these two components in the narratives.
And those are the things that work the best, actually, right? So when you go out and you be very didactic and try to tell people what a starfish does, won't capture it the same way as having nice animation and a story behind it, the way that Isabella put it together.
But and I think there is a scientific reason for it.
For
this. I think that scientists, because I went now and study science, and I always talk to Diana or my other professor saying, you know, I work in film, I work in art, I'm an actress. Everything is based on empathy. And when you study science, there is never the study of empathy. It's only a very cold look. The fish looked to the left, it went to the right, it did this, it did that. And the fear of attributing your own feelings to an animal and therefore defeat science that has to be impartial. But by being impartial, it becomes something so mechanic and rigid that we don't relate to, because we are creatures of empathy. Yeah. So I don't know what is the right media. I wish I could find the solution, but empathy has to be in the scientific equation. I don't know how you can calculate it, because it's gut feeling, and gut feeling by definition is not scientific, but once you eliminate that, you don't understand what you're seeing.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Well, I think the empathy comes in when we're trying to communicate it, and not a lot of scientists are not very effective at doing that, and that's why we have to partner with artists and other people to make it known. But when you're in the job of fact-finding, which is what you're doing at the beginning, an observation, that's where you have to be sort of not empathetic, but actually writing down what you see and trying to take yourself out of the way so you don't influence the observation.
Yes.
But then I agree with you, when we get to the part of interpreting the results, right? So there are steps. First, you have to take your data, then you have to interpret your data. And when you're interpreting the data and learning how to communicate the data at that point, you might want to bring in some idea of empathy to talk about it from, this is how it is on our side, and this is how it might be perceived on a different side. Mm-hmm. But for sure, at the first level, you want there to be an impartial collection of the facts.
Yes, no, yeah. I understand that there is that need. You know, and you could see the impartial collection. I was amazed at the detail that the French filmmaker did, you know, lingered in the body. I'd never seen a shrimp so close by, you know. Yeah. And I played the shrimp.
Yeah. Yeah, one thing I always like to remember is that, you know, film shouldn't be mistaken for scientific evidence. You know, film is a medium in and of itself. There's no, like, methodology to it, per se. So there is a difference between film as an art form and film as education. And, you know, and I think the best films
have to be... But this tension between art and science, it always existed, or maybe not always, but it exists now when the world is divided between art and science. And I am very interested in just riding in
wave.
Between the wave. Exactly.
Yeah. And I think a lot of good comes from riding the wave, because it not only sparks the scientists to think more creatively about what they're doing, but it might also spark the artists to want to show more stories that are not the traditional boy meets girl, boy loves girl, boy leaves girl, girl finds somebody
and
else.
And they, you know, and what about orgies? Well, they do everything. So boy meets girl, there's many more stories than boy meets girl out there.
Exactly, and that's what the nature is showing us.
Okay, so I wonder if anybody has any questions, you can raise your hand and right there.
You should know they're studying green porno at the university. While I was at the University of Pennsylvania, I went to a lecture on green porno as it relates to Deleuze and Guattari's Becoming Animal. My question is, it seems very clearly that you're using sort of the nature of the avatar of celebrity. The only other character in the film besides the animal is the biologist. Just sort of, and then you're dressed up as the animal, sort of like become the animal to create the sort of this kind of empathy. Our relationship with the celebrity is dressed up as the animal. So I'm just curious if you could talk more about this creating of kinship, of empathy, and the difficulties of when we have such a difficulty of not exploiting and killing our own kin, how do we develop, you know, empathy for animals and not exploit and not, like, kill animals?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I'm not, I don't know how to solve problems. But, you know, I feel that we're very empathic, you know. I have a little farm and I have chickens, and I can never eat the chicken. I'm carnivore. I mean, I'm not a vegetarian. And I eat chicken, but I do not eat my chickens. And I was really, I thought, you know, because I'm an actress, I'm a model, I'm urban, I'm so stupid. If I'm really a farmer, I should eat my chicken. And then one day I met at a conference to great Temple Grandin, you know, this fantastic scientist that redesigned all the slaughterhouse. She's autistic, and she uses her autism as an advantage to understand another species, because she's slightly different than all of us. And so she thinks that his problem that she has actually has opened another understanding for other creature who might have something similar to us, but also are different, like animal might be. And she said, oh no, that's very, she knows every farmer in America. She goes through slaughterhouse farming. She said, oh no, that happens a lot. We always eat our neighbor's animals. That was such a relief. But see, we are a creature of empathy. If you know, you can't. If you know them personally. That's why also maybe these films, or my father's film, was like a little fairy tale, but there was this desire to identify individual, the little fish that was looking for a mate, and the octopus that was attacked by the other fish. There was a need to not to generalize. Once they become person, that's it. You can't eat them.
And this is a real big issue right now in science, the personification of some of the animals that we use in the lab. And so there was a case with a chimpanzee, and I think the chimpanzee won in London. And so now in Great Britain, you can't do research on chimps anymore. And and some people push back. They're like, well, we have to study animals. It's the only way we can learn about us. That's not always true. I think it's forcing scientists to become more inventive and to use some innovation and doing things in cells instead of in live creatures. But again, that's sort of reductionist. And when you test things in a cell, you've isolated the whole rest of the body and you're not sure what's going to go. So there's always a push and pull with new technology of how far we can go in order. As we learn more, we try to do better, and we don't do is animal cruelty studies and all of those things have come a far way, but we still need animals in for a lot of the studies that we're doing. And but there are methods that are being developed to make it that we need less of them in order to find out
legally,
the answers.
I just want to clarify that the word person can be applied to animals, and they're trying to apply them to animals. Mm-hmm.
That was the case in London. Yeah.
Yes, that was the case in London, and he's an entity that has knows pain, suffering, and then deserve not to suffer. Yes, the research might be needed, or farm might be needed, but maybe we can lessen their, you know, I try to make my chicken very happy.
If you're interested, there is actually a D.A. Pennebaker documentary about Stephen Weiss, who's the lawyer who's bringing
that.
Oh
yes, Stephen Weiss is very wonderful.
Yeah. Okay, anyone else? Yeah, right in front.
I wondered about that, talking about empathy. In the one with the seahorse,
I saw the seahorse cut open. I mean, it was cut open. We saw the eggs. And I could have sworn that seahorse's head was still kind of looking and bobbing. Was it alive? Ouch.
No. The seahorse has been sacrificed. It's gone. But that is a very, very hard scene. When I saw that scene, yeah, too, I was like, whoa.
Did they put the seahorse to sleep?
Probably. There's several ways in which you can sacrifice animals, and actually there's guidelines. There are national guidelines that you have to follow when you're working with animals for how you sacrifice them. You can't bludgeon them.
In laboratory studies.
But he was a scientist.
In labs they're more protected, and in farms right, there's no protections. Yeah. Farms is much more cruel to animal than medical studies.
Okay, we have time for one or two more, so, yeah.
And just to add on to that, I was thinking they could have had a drawing of the same thing.
Well, you have to see it before you can draw it, right? And so it's the same reason why for female pregnant, when females get pregnant, we know a lot about fertilization, but we know nothing about implantation. Because right now, the law of the land is you can't study that, because it requires taking the egg past the level of where some people are comfortable. And so with animals, we're able to go through that whole cycle. Like, you're able to see the fertilization, the implanting, the eggs, the hatching, all of the stuff. But for humans, we only have select glimpses of that process. And the rest of it, we sort of glean from animals and think it happens the same way. But so there are times when you have to sort of see things like that where it's not nice and it's kind of grueling. But in order for our knowledge to grow, we need to explore and understand what's happening in those animals. Well, the film also was a tool for teaching at the time. So remember, this was turn of the century when he was doing it. And a lot of people didn't know how reproduction happened in seahorses, and they didn't know that it was the male that carried it. And actually, there's a colleague, Tony Wilson, at Brooklyn College, who studies pregnancy in seahorses, and he just did a genetic study to identify that the genes in seahorses are very similar to the genes that women have in their uterus, and the proteins that are being used are quite similar. So the story of nature always finding a good story and repeating it is the same with the seahorse.
Okay, up there.
The first three movies that we saw were fascinating and interesting, but obviously very dated. And they weren't filmed with a current 2017 audience where Isabella's were. When they came out, were people fascinated and interested in them? Well, how were they received?
The seahorse, the first one that we saw, was the only commercially successful film that Jean Painlevé made. It was made for 100,000 francs, and it grossed about the same amount. And he did say he was very pleased with it. He was like riding on the bus one day, and he heard someone say, "Oh, did you see that film about the male giving birth?" But his other ones, they weren't commercially successful. Yeah. Okay. One more.
I would just like to add one more to that answer. Yeah. In the scientific world, he got a lot of pushback for the kind of films he were making.
Yes.
Because they didn't think it was an appropriate medium for communicating the information. In science, you write a paper and you have to defend your paper against your peers. And here he were making films and trying to show them and say, this is how it's done. So he did get a lot of pushback in the scientific world for what he was doing, even though the public, for the most part, was happy to see the movies.
Yeah, Sarah.
So just to follow up on that, I work with a lot of students, and everybody knows about the seahorses. Like, all middle school kids know that male seahorses. I've always wondered where that came from. Is there enough evidence to believe that this film that sort of popularized? You might have.
Well, the first time I saw it was in high school, in AP Biology in Brooklyn Tech. And so they showed us the seahorse film, and that was the first that I saw it.
I mean, this was the first documentation of a seahorse giving birth. And it was commercially successful. It was also, in French in France. So there were some limits to distribution and things like that. So I don't know exactly. I mean, it's a pretty amazing thing.
Oh, but nowadays we see on television, it is Animal Channel. They just show all day long. So you do get your information much more than then.
Yeah. Okay, so thank you guys so much. We do have to wrap up.
I just want to say, please save the date if you're interested, and I hope you are, for the next Science on Screen program. It's going to be on May 21st, and it's a screening of the 1920 German Expressionist film, The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. We're going to have a live music score and a discussion about sleepwalking. So please come, and again, if you like, join us across the street. Thank you.